In here to do a live stream planning retreat tomorrow and Tuesday, so we'll have the cordless phone in here with us, but be patient if we don't get something quickly. Tuesday evening is the staff parish meeting. Wednesday is the McFriends breakfast. Wednesday Bible study at 11. McFriends breakfast is at 8. We have the choir dinner, so if you're in the other service and want to be a part of the choir, that's at 5 o'clock on Wednesday. So then the next Sunday is the Taste of Stout Memorial, and I'm getting really excited. So we have lots of wonderful recipes, and I keep looking out there and thinking, oh, that one looks good, that one looks good. So I'm excited about that. And craft night is then the next Tuesday, and we're making the little painted truck, and then you can put different things for each season in it, and it fits on a wreath, and you could put it on your door. It's really, really cute. And then choir practice starts next Wednesday. So we have lots of things coming up, lots of wonderful things. And there's also information in your newsletter about flood relief in Kentucky. So if you would like to help with that, there's information about how to what information to put on your check, and just put it in the offering, and we'll make sure it gets there. Stacy has another announcement.
Good morning. Pastor Cindy and I met with Jennifer Sisson from our preschool committee a couple weeks ago, along with the director, Mindy Hilling, and one of the teachers, Andrea, to talk about our playground. Most of you probably haven't even been to that side of the building in a while, let alone come in and out those doors to see that playground, but it's an embarrassment. Our equipment is old and dilapidated looking, and quite frankly, some of it probably isn't really even safe. We've got grass and weeds coming up through the rubber mulch we've got out there. The fence has been damaged. The gate, even though it's locked, you can pull it up from the hinge side and open it that way. So we've got a lot of work to do over there. I feel, and I think a lot of us feel, that we have the best preschool in the county, private or otherwise. And one reason I feel this is because I hear from parents and teachers alike in the county that our kids are the most prepared for kindergarten when they get there. But I feel like people driving down the street see the nice big banner, registration open, and see that playground. That playground is their first impression of our school, and it's a mess. So what we would like to do is have a shower, so to speak, just like a baby shower, a wedding shower, have a playground shower. And during our meeting, we looked up some things, decided what needed to go. The swing set needs to go. The four-seat teeter-totter needs to go. There's a tall basketball hoop, gone. A lot of that stuff we need to get rid of, and we're going to need to replace it. So as you could hear from the long list of things we have coming up, I kind of dropped the ball this week and didn't get the pictures and slides to Sam in time for you guys to really be able to see up there, but I'll have those next week. But I do have pictures, and I'll lay them in the back so you guys can look at them. But these are the wish list. These are what they would like to have. Everything on here is from Walmart. There is a little garden wheelbarrow cart, and all of these are age appropriate, ages 3 and up. Here is a little slide climbing thing. They can get in the center of that and play. Here is an inflatable. It's got balls in it, but you can also play basketball and do other things with it. I think they've got one or two of these out there, but they're kind of in bad shape. So these blow bubbles, little lawn mowers, the swing set to replace the one we have out there. This one's even nicer, and I think this one was $149 or $199. It was not a bad price for this at all. This would replace the teeter-totter. Here is a small trampoline. It would only hold one, maybe two in there, and it's safe and secure, and it's for ages 3 and up. Here's a little waddle disc, I think it's called. And then we talked about what to do with the base. And they said, let's just put grass in there. That way we don't have to worry. We'll put some of that mulch, save all that rubber mulch, put it under the swing set, but let's just put grass. We can mow it, you know, weed whack, whatever. But we have found, Cindy found, turf on Amazon. It's got foam underneath. It's not like the AstroTurf that you have to do at the football stadiums, and these interlock, and they've got foam underneath. And I've got information about that as well. These are about $59, I think, per 2.7 square feet. So you said probably around $1,000 to do the playground with this. Wouldn't have to be mowed. It would be fantastic to have. So what we would be asking from you all is to either buy these items and donate them, or donate money and we can purchase whatever. If you have any questions about any of these, see Cindy or myself or Jennifer Sisson. We'd be happy to answer your questions. But you know, the kids use that playground and a lot of these things. In the winter, when the weather's bad, they can bring them in, put them in the gym, and play with them too. So, do you have any questions right now? If you want to put it in the offering and just put playground on it, or yes, you can just give it to me or Cindy or Sam in the office, whichever. So, all right. Thank you very much.
Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
It's good to hear that we have a lot of things going on. I know there for a while it seemed like nothing was going to ever be going on again, but it's great to have things going on. It's great to see so many faces here with us.
Good looking group out there.
It is a good looking group out there. But let's get started with our call to worship. Come and worship Christ, the visible image of the invisible God, the firstborn of creation, the eternal God, the one through whom all things were created, and in whom all things are held together. Let's worship our God together. Amen. Our first song of worship is Overwhelmed. It just picked a couple of really good songs that just speak of God's beauty and power and splendor this morning. But let's sing Overwhelmed.
Spinning a heavenly dance, oh God, all that you are is so overwhelming. And I hear the sound of your voice all at once. It's a gentle and thundering noise, oh God, all that you are is so overwhelming. In you, in the glory of your presence, I'm overwhelmed. I'm overwhelmed by you, God. I'll run into your arms unashamed because of mercy. You've done is so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, in the glory of your presence. I'm overwhelmed. I'm overwhelmed by you. I'm overwhelmed by you. beautiful, you are beautiful, oh God. There is no one more beautiful, you are beautiful, God, you are the most beautiful. You are wonderful, you are wonderful, oh God. There is no one more wonderful, you are wonderful, God, you are the most wonderful. Oh, you are glorious, you are glorious, oh God. There is no one more glorious, you are glorious, God, you are the most glorious.
God, we thank you so much for bringing us to this place to worship you this morning, to feel your overwhelming presence surround us, to see your beauty as it touches our lives, to feel your mercy embrace our hearts. Lord God, I ask that you just fill us with your spirit as we worship you, Lord. Just prepare our hearts to receive your word and your message this morning. Help us to be your light shining in this world, to be your voice, sharing your mercy with others. All of this we pray in your most holy and precious name. Amen. We see the beauty of God even in the little ones that cry because they're not getting their way. But, I know one of the first times I ever preached in this church, I don't remember if it was at something special we did in there or at a regular service, but there was one child that would not stop crying. And, you just got to block it out and keep right on going, and that's, as parents, I think you try to do that. You think if you just ignore it, it goes away, and then you think you get frustrated when God does the same thing because you're not doing what God wants you to do, and God's just ignoring you. He's saying, I ain't giving you that, I ain't doing this for you. You keep praying and asking for it, I'm just ignoring you. But, sometimes we got to remember God is our Father, and there are times that He might be ignoring us a little bit, but it's for our benefit. And, sometimes we just got to listen and mind, or He'll spank us. But anyway, our God is great this morning, and we're going to sing Great Are You, Lord. Your breath, you give life.
restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, we pour out our praise to you, Holy. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope.
Do we have joys to share this morning? It is. It's great to see everyone. Do we have concerns we need to add to our prayer list? You guys are a quiet house this morning.
Actually, Cindy, my friend Bill Walker is going for his cancer surgery in Morgantown this Wednesday.
Let's keep Dee in our prayers. Is she out of the hospital? Okay. Yes.
We have great Mother's News breakfast this morning. A lot of discussion. There seems to be a lot of people needing prayer.
A lot of hurting people. No complications.
You can pray for our teachers and students.
Yes. School starts this week. Let's bow in prayer. Lord, your holy presence is so evident in this place this morning. We ask that you would continue to fill us, fill this place, fill each heart, fill each mind, and to be with those that are on our hearts and minds. Lord, there's so much need, and there's so many that are struggling, and we ask that we believe that you have the power to touch each and every one of those lives, to bring your healing touch where it's needed, to bring your guidance where it's needed, to bring your power and presence into each place. And Lord, we just allow all of those to be placed in your hands and every need to be realized that it's heard and answered. Lord, guide us, we pray, as we continue to strive to be the guiding light in this world that you've called us to be. And Lord, as we open our hearts now and we open your word, we ask that you would enlighten us, brighten us, and encourage us. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Well, this morning, we're looking in Colossians chapter 1. I think Sam has verses 15 through 20. We're going to go to verse 9. Okay. So for this reason also, ever since we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We keep asking God that you might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, to please him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work and growing in the knowledge of God. We pray that you may be strengthened with all the power that comes from his glorious might. For you have all kinds of patience and steadfastness. With joy, we give thanks to the Father who qualified you to share in the inheritance of the Spirit in the light. The inheritance of the saints in the light. Is that Kirshim? He rescued us from the domain of the darkness and brought us into the kingdom of the Son whom he loves. In him we have redemption, the release of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things are created in heaven and on earth, the seen and the unseen, whether thrones or angelic powers or rulers or authorities. All was created through him and for him. I don't know if I got, but we're going to stop right there, Greg. Okay. This letter was written to the people of Colossia, and these people had come to Christ through the preaching of Epaphras. And he was probably said to be their pastor, but he had come to Christ in Ephesus, and then he had taken that calling and had gone back to his town of Colossia and had started a church. And so he was coming to Rome to meet with Paul to talk to him about the church and give him an account of the church and what was going on there in Colossia. And so Paul was writing back to the people of Colossia and telling them how to address the issues and the problems that Epaphras had told him was going on there. Now, this Colossia was a city in the kingdom of Phrygia, and that is in modern-day Turkey. So if you could kind of see, it's going toward, it was going toward the east, going toward the eastern part of Turkey, and it was one of the chief cities in that kingdom. And the church that was there that Epaphras had started was struggling with a few things. There were some threats against the church. One of the threats was that this was an area filled with volcanic activity and earthquakes. So they were struggling. They struggled with earthquakes and volcanoes. And this city was said to have been destroyed by a volcano, an earthquake, not too long after this was written. But the people weren't really concerned about a physical things that were dangerous for them. They were concerned about spiritual things that were dangerous for them. And Epaphras was concerned for them. And so he's reminding us once again that the spiritual things are more important than our fears of the physical world around us. Epaphras was trying to address their spiritual needs, and even though they were destroyed by an earthquake not long after this was written, they needed these things addressed, and this was the most important. The immediate threat was, who do we believe? Many voices in this very diverse city, people coming from all directions and all different kinds of beliefs, all different religious beliefs, had brought confusion into the city and into these people. Who's right? Who's wrong? What do we believe? There was the Jewish Christian community, and they said, we follow Jesus, but we must also follow the law. We must keep our traditions that we've had all of these years, and we must. There was within the Christian community many different views on how we are to follow Christ, and there were many different groups who decided that this is how we follow Christ, and so there were different groups within the Christian community, and during this time was the beginning of what was known as the Gnostic movement. G-N-O-S-T-I-C, and I don't know if you've studied the Gnostics, but they believed that they were Christians, and they were a part of the Christian movement, but they believe that salvation is gained through a special form of a secret knowledge. And they believed that there were two different groups of people, the carnal people, or the inferior people, and the spiritual people who were superior. And the superior people could comprehend the spiritual things of the world. And the carnal people, the ones who couldn't comprehend God, the inferior people, would never obtain salvation. So you comprehended the secret knowledge, the spiritual knowledge, and then that's how you obtained salvation. But they also believed that there was more than one God, They believe that there was a superior God, a God in heaven that's superior above all, but they believe that there were lesser gods. And those lesser gods helped the superior God to work with humankind. There was humankind and God, and then all in between that were all of these other gods who helped the superior God to take care of these humankind. And so they also believed that there were no rules, no real rules. There was a superior God and the lesser gods that helped to encourage good attitudes. So there was really no rules to live by. You just have to have a good attitude. They believe that there was no attachment to the, you should have no attachment to the world. We should all live in this spiritual world and kind of detach ourselves from the physical world. And we should respect everyone's freedom. Freedom for everyone to be who they needed to be. That's how they believed we should exist. We kind of detach ourselves from the world, and everyone's free to be who they need to be. And we have to find this gnosis or this knowledge before we die, or we get stuck between this world and the next world. And if we get stuck between this world and the next world, then it's very likely that we get sent back here to this world until we gain the spiritual superiority that we need to get to the higher world. So that was what the Gnostics believed. And it was a very prominent group that was teaching and preaching that this was the way to God. And then in these cities, there were also pagan worship, pagan gods that were worshiped. And if you became Christian and said that you will no longer worship these other gods, you only worship the one God, and something horrible happens, if there was an earthquake or volcanic activity or anything else, a natural disaster happened, a drought or disease, it was deemed to be your fault because you didn't worship the God of that, of health, or you didn't worship the God of no earthquakes, or you didn't worship the God that protected us from all of these different things. And so it was your fault that these disasters had happened. And so the local politics believed that these people should be destroyed because they're causing us to have these problems. They didn't worship the right God. And so your life could be put in danger. So do we have to put our lives in danger to follow God? Who's right? Who's wrong? And so we can understand just a little bit better by understanding what was happening in their city, the struggle that they were going through. To understand what they believed, who they believed, do we put our lives in danger? Do we do this? Do we have to do that? They didn't have a Bible. They didn't have anything in written form. They didn't have a study guide. They didn't have a Sunday school class. They didn't have any of those things. They had the stories that Epaphras had learned while he was under Paul, and he had gone back and taught those things, but he didn't have anything in written form, and this was the first letter that Paul had sent back to them. He didn't have all the answers to their questions. And so he sought Paul's wisdom. And Paul could have said, "You're out of luck. I'm in prison." And really, Paul was put to death not long after this was written. So Paul's life was in severe danger, but he didn't. Paul sent back some information to help them understand that they needed to have a new hope in this very confusing world. He was trying to bring them some security, some peace in the midst of all the threats and all the different voices that they were hearing. And he said to them, "Listen only to Jesus. Follow that you've heard the teachings that Jesus gave while he was here on earth. Follow only that. If it doesn't line up with the teachings that Jesus taught while he was here, it is not what we need to be following. Stay focused on thanksgiving. Stay focused on the celebration of what we've been given through Jesus Christ. To understand Jesus, you need to understand grace. I used to ask people all the time, what is grace? You guys keep talking about grace, and what is it? And they give you this acronym of God. You guys probably know it. Help me out. God, you don't know it either, do you? G-R-A-C-E. We're not deserving of God's presence, and I can't think of it right now. I should have looked it up or written it down, but it's on a board in Stacy's office. where's Stacy when we need her? But they would give me that acronym, and that still didn't help me understand. And I did a lot of searching to try to find out what it means. What does it mean? Our God's riches at Christ's expense. That's G-R-A-C-E. But that didn't really help me understand it very well. God's riches at Christ's expense. Christ died so we could have God's riches. But that still didn't help me grasp what it was really meaning. And so I was struggling to understand grace. And I was struggling. And I think a lot of people are struggling in this world that we live in still today. It's a world filled with confusion, isn't it? It's not unlike the world that the Colossia people were living in. It's got a lot of political confusion. Who's right? Who's wrong? What do I believe? What do I follow? What do I not believe? It's got a lot of religious confusion. I have people ask me all the time, how do I know what church is right? How do I know which one I should be going to? How do I know which religion is right? Not just a church, but even in the Christian church, there are many denominations. But how do I know that the Christian church is right? Are you telling me everyone that's involved in everything outside of Christianity is going to hell? So you got all these people that are not, say they're not Christian. Are you telling me all of them are going to hell? Is God just not like them? Are they the inferior? I have people ask me, how could God destroy that many people? This God that we call a loving God and he has all these riches, how could he do that? And what about the people who don't know anything about Jesus, who haven't been told anything about Jesus, who haven't had anyone to teach them? Do they just go to hell? And so in my searching of what it means to have grace, in my searching of trying to find answers for other people who have questions, I'll tell you a little bit about what I've discovered. In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 16, it says, "This is the covenant I will make with them after that time, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds." Now, it doesn't say that I will put my laws on the superior people's hearts, did it? It didn't say that I will put my laws and write my laws on their minds and on their hearts of just a few people. It says them, all people. So I believe we all have the laws of God, the things of God written on our hearts and on our minds. John Wesley called that prevenient grace, that God loves every human being and poured his laws, his desires, everything on our hearts and our minds. And that drives us to seek and to find justification through God. That's what draws us to God. That's what draws us to go find, to search, to think about God. And all humankind has it. God put it on every heart. The Holy Spirit drawing us to the truth, to find the truth. And what is the truth? Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Every indigent group that's ever been discovered that I've been able to read about has a story that is, they have a form of Christ that is worshiped in their tribe or in their group of people. You remember in Acts when Paul said to the people in Athens, "Let me tell you about the unknown God." He was this group of people had a God that they didn't know the name of, but they worshiped. And it was Christ-like. The American Indian, when we came here to this land, they worshiped the Great Spirit. Every group has a God that they worshiped. It may not be named Jesus, but it is like Christ. So I believe that God has drawn and put that on every human being's mind and every human being's heart, and we seek it even if we don't know the name of it, the Holy Spirit, God, Christ. What we call the Christ that we worshiped, if we haven't been told the correct name, if no one has come to tell us that this is Jesus that we're worshiping. But I am sure that we have to seek the truth and the way and the life. And I know that God has written the truth on our hearts, and we have to seek that. And when people come and give us the name of Christ, then we can put that truth with the name, and we can put that together in our lives. But I believe that Jesus Christ is grace. What is grace? Jesus. And we won't get to heaven without grace. What does that mean? We won't get to heaven in our own power. Grace is receiving God without my own power. Grace is God coming to me without my asking or knowing. Grace is God pouring His truth into my heart and into my mind without my knowing, without my asking. Grace is God's work in us without us knowing what it is. Jesus is grace. He came to us not being asked by us. He came and brought us the truth without us knowing or seeking or asking. We can't get to heaven in our own power. We get to heaven because we seek the one who brought us grace, who brought us the power that we need. We get to heaven because Jesus brought that power to us. God brought that power to us. We know it's Jesus. We have been taught and we know that power is Jesus Christ. That's the truth. And if we join any group that tells us anything different, we're in the wrong group. If we join any group that says you have to have enough faith in order to have the things of God, you're in the wrong group. If you join a group that says that you have to be good enough to receive things from God, you're in the wrong group. If you join a group that says you have to give enough to receive the blessings of God, then you're in the wrong group. If you join a group that says you have to serve enough, if you have to study enough, any doctrine that emphasizes you doing enough to receive the blessings of God is not the truth. And that's as simple as it gets. Any doctrine that emphasizes my power is leading you down the wrong path. Any group that emphasizes grace, God's power saves us, brings us salvation, and that is the truth. Obedience is birthed out of grace. Grace is not birthed out of obedience. God's blessings are not birthed out of our obedience. And I hope I'm saying that clear enough, plain enough. Our obedience is birthed out of God's grace. It's not the other way around. I can't do enough, be enough, or act good enough to receive. God brings it, and then I want to do. Grace brings the balance between obedience and God's power just being there for us. If you don't want to serve, or if you don't want to give, if you don't want to study and you don't want to grow, and I'm not talking about me this morning not wanting to get out of bed. I'm talking about if we have no desire for any of those things, then we don't have the power of grace. The power of grace brings that desire to us and we want to do it. We're driven by that inside of us that's bringing us to drive us to do those things. We're driven by grace. We're not driven by fear. We want to do it because we've received from God already. How do I know if I'm saved? What's your driving force? Is your driving force because you've been told that you're going to hell if you don't do these things? Or is your driving force the grace that lives within you that drives you to do? The law of grace written and empowered by the Holy Spirit. That's what we know. When we have that, we have salvation. That's our test. It takes practice to recognize that truth that lives within us. And often the enemy disguises the lies and makes us see things and think things are the truth when they're not. Do you know that Gnosticism is alive and well still today? Even though it's been deemed to be heretical by the first early church when they were writing the Nicene Creed, all of the Gnostic writings were said to not be a part of the canon, the Bible, because they were heretical. And you don't have to really dig very far to find it. It's alive and well in our churches today. There's a new movement in the Christian faith. It's called deconstructionalism. It's being taught in a lot of seminaries. And it looks pretty good. It says you have to detangle your beliefs or your faith traditions to get rid of things that might not be consistent with Scripture. Which sounds pretty good, doesn't it? Some of the faith teachings, some of the things you've been taught in church might not be consistent with Scripture. But it also goes a little further in saying that we also need to deconstruct Scripture. We need to reinterpret it based on our need or our culture. And it's changing because our culture is changing. So as our culture changes, Scripture must change too, and we must deconstruct it. Who's the primary focus of that movement? I must find what I need for my culture, for my day. I must deconstruct Scripture to fit my needs. See the litmus test? If it focuses on I, be careful. It's not what we need. Carl Jung was a renowned psychiatrist in the early 20th century, died in 1961. But if you dig a little deeper, he called himself the great modern Swiss Gnostic. He wore a ring with a serpent on it. And he believed that the serpent shows us the way to find hidden things. One of the quotes from his writings are, "If I had not become like the serpent, if I had not become like the serpent, the devil, the quintessence of everything serpent-like would have held this bit of power over me. This would have given the devil a grip, and he would have forced me to make a pact with him. But I forestalled him by uniting myself with the serpent, just as a man unites himself with a woman." That's a scary statement. Who has the power in that statement? I united myself with the serpent so that I could have power over the serpent. I forestalled him. I did. Our power is not in I. Our power is in God, in Jesus Christ, in the Holy Spirit that lives within us. Our hope, our power, our new life is in Jesus. It's in grace. That grace gives us the power. No power comes from I. So I found, how do I know that I'm in the right church? If it's a church that's teaching that the power of Jesus Christ is grace, it is our saving force, it is the driving force within us, that is how I know that they're leading me and teaching me to find salvation in Jesus Christ. If they're teaching me that I need to do in order to receive, then that's not a correct theology. And we need to be careful of what we believe and what we think within us, because God is leading us. He's planted that within us to lead us to all truth. And all truth is that we find our power in Jesus Christ. Jesus is the grace. Jesus is the power that leads us and guides us to all truth. We have no salvation in ourselves. Our salvation only comes from Jesus Christ and the power that is within us that drives us. If we're driven by self, we're in the wrong lane. If we're driven by Christ, we're in the right lane. I hope that helps us to understand and maybe understand the struggle that the Colossians had, but also the struggles that we still have today. Hope I haven't made it more confusing, because God wants us to know it's simple. Be driven by Christ and not by self. That's the litmus test that we all must use. Let's pray. Lord God, this world likes to make things so complicated, and we complicate them in trying to explain. Lord, there's so many things out there that sound so good. But Lord, you're the only thing that we need. You're the one that brings us the power. And only you can bring the power that we need for salvation, for healing, for new life, for finding our way in the midst of confusion, for all of the answers. Help us to not seek other places, but to know that in you we find grace, we find your goodness. We didn't deserve it. We didn't deserve Jesus, but he brought us your goodness. He is your goodness. He is your grace. And in him, may we find truth. May we find power. And may we find salvation. Lord, continue to lead and guide us. Amen.
saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, as ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
In my searching to understand grace, I found the church that understands it the best is the United Methodist Church. And I think that that's why the United Methodist Church has been attacked and tried to be torn down, torn apart. John Wesley had a powerful understanding of grace. And so to study his understanding is a powerful way to start. But I believe we need to pray for the United Methodist Church, because I believe this church has the best balance of understanding of grace. It is got its problems like every other denomination and every other church, but this church leads us to find grace, and that's why I'm here. And I think that that's why we all need to pray for this, for the United Methodist Church and that our denomination. God bless you in your search, and let's all come to Christ in one. Amen. Amen. Amen.